Okay, now our subject is the Sermon on the Mount. And last week I introduced or sketched for you the kingdom of God in Scripture. And an important aspect of that, I did that because the kingdom of God to me is a very key thing. It really deals with God's rescue of His creation. So it's really a dominant theme that flows all the way through. And a key aspect of the kingdom is that it was introduced or inaugurated in association with Jesus' first coming, but it will not be consummated or finalized until Jesus arrives again. And if you were here, I hope this diagram of that idea at least rings a bell. You see here that you have this inauguration and a consummation. So we live in this overlap of ages. When the kingdom of God is present, it is a reality, but there's also this ongoing old age of Satan, where we have death and sin and suffering. It coexists with the kingdom of God. But there is this day coming when Christ returns, where all that is contrary to God's eternal vision and purpose will be stripped out, and the kingdom of God will be the sole reality. So I hope that at least rings a bell. As I said, I went through all of that because I think the kingdom of God is an important concept generally. I just think that people need to understand this because it is so important for New Testament theology to see this. So it's important generally, but I also did it so you'll understand what I mean when I say that my approach to the Sermon on the Mount is one of inaugurated eschatology, which is the approach of many evangelical scholars. As Craig Blomberg writes in his commentary on Matthew, he says, inaugurated eschatology recognizes an already not yet tension in which the sermon's ethic remains the ideal or goal for all Christians in every age, but which will never be fully realized until the consummation of the kingdom at Christ's return. In other words, the sermon shows us how we are to live as participants in the kingdom that Christ ushered in. And it is a radical vision. It is a radical vision, which is what you'd expect from the radical nature of the kingdom of God. So that should not surprise us. Now, the fact that we are not yet as Christ-like as we will be when the kingdom is consummated at Christ's return means that we will fail to live up to this ideal fully. But the ideal remains the goal. It remains the target. We don't dismiss it and then say, well, we're not going to achieve it completely. Therefore, just blow it off and don't worry about it. And you're saved by grace. And no, we strive for this. This is the goal and the target of our ethic, what we're striving to be. We are to strive to conform our lives to this teaching and thereby to glorify God. And as we do so, as I said at the end last week, as we do so, our failures are not a source of anxiety. We are not spiritual neurotics. And that is because we understand that our existence and our life in the kingdom of God is not something that we achieve by our performance. We're not earning it. So our failures are not a matter of saying, oh no, you know, this is it, I'm out, I'm in, I'm out, I'm in. It's not like that. And so we just get up and keep walking. Fall up, fall up, fall up. What are we doing? We're walking. See, we're pursuing Jesus. And we do that in complete peace. Because as we do that, His blood continues to cleanse us from all sin and from all failures. All right, now, many are convinced, Matthew's Sermon on the Mount, of course, is Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Many are convinced that Matthew's Sermon on the Mount and Luke's Sermon on the Plain in Luke chapter 6, verse 17 to 49... that they're two different accounts of the same occasion. There are many people that see it that way. You see that we have one sermon that was given, and you have two different accounts of that same sermon. They believe that Jesus, see, He preached it up on some plateau or level area up in the hills. So Matthew talks about a Sermon on the Mount, whereas Luke then focuses that He was on the level area up in the hills. And then the differences in the two accounts, in what's reported and how it's arranged, those are then attributed to the different interests and the different purposes that Matthew and Luke have their audiences, the Spirit moving them to write to their particular audience, so they're arranged differently, and that's how they account for the differences, and also possibly differences in the sources that Matthew drew on and that Luke drew on. So there are many people that think that. Others, however, are convinced that Matthew's and Luke's accounts, they are of sermons that are delivered by Jesus on two separate occasions. One he preached a sermon on the Mount, and one he preached a sermon somewhere else on a plain. And so they're two separate occasions, and I lean in that direction. As Jack Lewis, who's a longtime professor, I think he still is emeritus at Harding Graduate School, as Lewis used to quip, if Jesus preached a sermon only one time, he'd be the only preacher ever to do so. You see, so I think that's right. I think, you know, he's preaching here, and then he'll go and he'll preach some other version of it somewhere else. Why? It's because it's good stuff. You see, it's good stuff. So I think that's in fact what's going on. Now, the Sermon on the Mount, which is reported in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, has been called the most superlative teaching on human ethics ever uttered by an individual. In a sermon in 1629, the English cleric and poet John Donne, he said of the sermon with excusable hyperbole, he said of that sermon, all the articles of our religion, all the canons, meaning the rules of our church, all the injunctions of our princes, our leaders, all the homilies of our fathers, all the body of divinity, the corpus of theological instruction, is in these three chapters in this one Sermon on the Mount. Now that's some pretty high talk about a lesson and about a sermon. You see, now Chris Latin, you don't know Chris Latin, because Chris Latin is the man who led my brother John to Christ in 1978, and I'm fond of him because John then led me to Christ, and in fact, today is my 37th spiritual birthday. I was baptized into Christ 37 years ago today. That's Chris spoke to John, and then John hounded me, you see. But Chris Latin, this man who led John to Christ in 1978, he was an atheist. And he began reading the New Testament to satisfy himself or to confirm its falsity. But when he finished reading the Sermon on the Mount, he was crying. This atheist, this really smart guy who'd gone through Camus and Nietzsche and all of these things, and he was going to read this New Testament and convince himself or affirm how bogus it was. And when he read the Sermon on the Mount, that just broke him. And the rest is, as they say, history. Now, there are probable allusions to the teaching in the Sermon on the Mount in Romans, in James, and in 1 Peter. And from the close of the New Testament, the end of the first century, to the Council of Nicaea in AD 325, Matthew chapter 5 is quoted more frequently and more extensively than any other chapter in the Bible. And Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7 are quoted more frequently and more extensively than any three chapters in the Bible. And when we get to the sermon itself, Matthew, you see in verse 1 says, it says, seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him in Matthew chapter 5, verse 1. See, verse 1, it refers to the crowds that are following Jesus. And this goes back to the end of the preceding chapter, to the end of chapter 4. And we read there, so his, Jesus' fame spread throughout all Syria. And they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed by demons, epileptics and paralytics, and he healed them. And great crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis and from Jerusalem and Judea and from beyond the Jordan. You see, Jesus is a happening. There is a buzz going on because, you remember, that's the whole thing. See, with the kingdom, what are people? They're waiting for the kingdom of God. They are waiting for this ultimate intervention of God where he intervenes in this world to set all things right, to heal this sin-sick world. And here comes Jesus in that environment, and he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. And he says in his ministry, if I cast out demons by the power of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. You see, so then what is he doing? He's saying, so everybody's going, wait, I hear this guy saying this stuff. Now what's he doing? Now he's doing miracles. Now he's healing people. So you can see people are going, whoa, you think this is it? Do you think this is really it? And so he's got a crowd. You see, there is a crowd that is attached, that has come around. There's quite a crowd. He created a buzz. The people were excited over his ministry. And in that environment, Jesus goes up some distance on a mountain and he sat down, which was a common posture for teachers in that day and time. You can see that, for example, in Luke chapter 4, verse 20. And his disciples, see, those who had attached themselves to him in some distinctive way, whatever disciple meant right at that time, there were people who were identified as disciples. They were attaching themselves, aligning themselves, associating themselves with Jesus in some distinct way. So he sits down, his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. Now, some people are convinced that Jesus deliberately chose a mountain setting for this profound sermon as an echo of Moses ascending Mount Sinai to receive the law of God. And in that regard, I do think it's interesting that the phrase, he went up on the mountain, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 1, it appears only three times in the Greek translation of the Old Testament. That phrase appears only three times, and all of those occurrences are references to Moses' ascent of Mount Sinai in Exodus 19:3, 24:18, and 34:4. Now, if Jesus was suggesting such a parallel by going up on the mountain to deliver this profound sermon, it would be to highlight, you see, that he is the prophet like Moses that was referred to in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 to 19. One who, as was true of Moses, came to deliver or save his people. Like, this is who Moses is. We think of Moses as a lawgiver. He is that. But he was seen in Israel. He's a deliverer. He is a savior. And so if Jesus is making that allusion and drawing that parallel by what he's doing, he's doing it to say, I am the prophet. I am the prophet like Moses, the one referred to in Deuteronomy chapter 18. But of course, any presentation of Jesus as Moses-like doesn't diminish the fact that he's greater than Moses, right? I mean, we know that. He's greater than Moses. He is the Lord. He is the Son of God. Now, Jesus is teaching his disciples in this sermon. You see that expressly in Matthew chapter 5, verse 2. But the crowds that surrounded him, or one or two, the crowds that surrounded them, they're taking in his words. I mean, he's teaching his disciples, but you've got these crowds around him. They're not just sitting here, you know, putting their hands over their ears. They're sucking this in. And you can see that because in Matthew 7:28, when he finishes, it reports that the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. So he's teaching his disciples, but the crowds are hearing what he's saying, and I assume Jesus is well aware of that. Now, Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 10, these are, of course, known as the Beatitudes. And that's an interesting, I mean, you've heard that all your life, but the Beatitudes, that comes from the Latin. And this happens with a lot of, you know, religious words that have come over to us from Latin. But here we have this word, Beatitudes. It comes from the Latin for blessedness, which is beatitudo. So that's why, where do we get this odd word? Why do we? Well, it just kind of came over from Latin. You see, it was beatitudo, and that in turn came from the Latin word for blessed, which is beatus. So that's where this comes from. Now, blessed generally describes the person who is in some special sense favored or approved by God, a privileged recipient of God's favor. That's what someone who is blessed is. Now, sometimes you see the word, and some people want like to ride this idea, that happy, you see it translated happy, but I don't really think that's a good translation. Because happy carries with it these connotations of subjective feelings rather than objective blessing. You see, happy deals with my state and my subjective appreciation of the blessings, where the focus is on the objective blessing. They are people who are blessed by God. You see, now being objectively blessed, favored by God, being someone who is privileged by God, well, that's a source of deep and inner joy. I wouldn't deny that for a second. You see, but I don't think that's the focus here. So I prefer the translation where it says blessed. Now, each particular blessing you see here in the Beatitudes, each particular blessing, it's specified by the second clause of the Beatitude. Right? As you look through them, you say, blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom. Mourn, for. You see, each one of these Beatitudes, the people who are identified as blessed, the particular blessing is specified in the second clause. For example, those who are poor in spirit are blessed in that, or because, that's the function of for. You see, blessed are the poor in spirit, in that, or because, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So you get the blessing is identified and specified in the second clause. Now, just as a footnote, the kingdom of heaven is just another way of referring to the kingdom of God. David Wenham, who's the fellow who taught New Testament at Oxford for many years, Wenham says the phrase kingdom of heaven is just an alternate way of saying kingdom of God. Matthew, writing his distinctively Jewish gospel, uses the alternative expression because it refers to God indirectly, a circumlocution, a roundabout way of saying something. It refers to God indirectly, as Jews often did, rather than directly. And perhaps because it makes clear that the kingdom in question is not a purely this worldly kingdom. And yet the kingdom which Jesus proclaimed was not just up in heaven, it was more like an invasion of earth by heaven. That's what I've tried to communicate to you when I was talking about the kingdom. I said it's as though the not yet has been pulled into the now. You see, and that's what he's getting at with that. But I just want you to see this idea. Kingdom of heaven is just another way of referring to the kingdom of God. Now, the Beatitudes proper, they run through verse 10. So you have eight Beatitudes. They run Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 through Matthew chapter 5, verse 10. Verses 11 and 12 aren't really Beatitudes proper. What they are commentary or an elaboration on the eighth and final Beatitude, which is given in verse 10. You see, there an elaboration on or commentary on that. And you can see that. See, the break is confirmed by the fact you have a different form. So all along, you see in the Beatitudes proper, you have a certain very clear form. Blessed are somebody in third person. Okay? Blessed are poor in spirit, those who mourn, meek, those who hunger and thirst, merciful, pure in heart, peacemakers, those who are persecuted. Blessed are some third person reference, and then followed by a clause that begins with for that gives the content of the blessing. So you have a very standardized form, and that pattern is broken when you get to verse 11. Here you see 10, I picked up the last of the Beatitudes proper, and you see, blessed are those third person who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for there. Now when you get to 11 and 12, blessed are you second person. You see, this is an elaboration on or commentary on the last Beatitude. And you also see there's no for. So you have this very clear pattern. You get to verse 11, that pattern is no longer there. So the Beatitudes proper, eight of them, run from Matthew 5, verse 3, down through Matthew 10. Now, note that verses 3 and 10, they have the identical blessing. Okay, they have the identical blessing, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. They have the identical blessing, and that structure you see that marks this out as a single literary unit, and it indicates that everything between verses 3 and 10 likewise pertains to the kingdom. So blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Then we come down here and repeat that, this inclusio, this thing where you have beginning and end, where we block it off. And then the implication is that everything between them likewise pertains to the kingdom of heaven, concerns that. In other words, the blessings of these intervening beatitudes, where you get from verses 4 through 9, between 5:3 and 5:10, they are kingdom blessings. And the subjects of those blessings, they are described by kingdom norms. They are described by kingdom norms, by attitudes and characteristics typical of disciples, kingdom participants. So that's what's going on here. Now, the fact the blessings in verses 3 and 10, here's another little thing here. You see the blessings in verse 3 and 10, they're present tense. The fact the blessings in verses 3 and 10 are present tense, whereas all the blessings in the intervening verses are future, this is a nod, you see. It's probably an acknowledgement that though the full blessedness of these beatitudes awaits the consummation of the kingdom, the full and ultimate experience of these promised blessings awaits the consummation of the kingdom, a foretaste of these blessings is presently available. It is available in the here and now, in the kingdom that was inaugurated in connection with Christ's coming. So even here, you see, you get this now and not yet. You get this already and still to come. And it's suggested here with kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven is and then future. Is and future. So that's why, why do you go through all that stuff on the kingdom? Because it's how I understand the Sermon on the Mount. You see, it's all through here, this idea of this inaugurated eschatology where we have Jesus inaugurating the kingdom, bringing it, ushering it in. Then we live in this overlap of ages. Then we have the coming, and then we have the consummation or the finalization. And so I think that's what's being suggested here. Okay, you're glad to know we're going to go to the first beatitude. All right, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The Lord says that those who are poor in spirit are blessed, in that they are the ones to whom entrance is provided into the kingdom of heaven. And I'll say they're blessed, right? If we're talking about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, the thing that righteous people and prophets longed for and looked for, and here he's saying, theirs is the kingdom of God. Well, then I'll say, yeah, that's an understatement. They're blessed indeed. They're certainly blessed, right? They enter into the glorious kingdom that Jesus is ushering in, a state of present divine blessing that will culminate in the eternal glory of the divine utopia. It will culminate in that, the new heavens and the new earth. And Jesus said in Mark chapter 10, verse 29 and 30, just to see both sides of this, the blessings now and the blessings to come, the now and the not yet of kingdom blessings. You see Jesus in Mark 10, 29 and 30. Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive a hundredfold now in this time. What do you mean? Are you talking about? So kingdom participants are already being blessed richly. Houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands. We're talking about the church. We're talking about our fellowship, our brotherhood, our relationship with one another. And then he says, with persecutions, which he'll talk about, and in the age to come, eternal life. You see, blessings now, but there's a different kind of blessing that will come. There will be a different blessing in the resurrection state. And that's what Jesus is speaking about here. Well, who are these poor in spirit? The poor in spirit who are brought by God into the kingdom, who are they? What's the connection between their description and their blessing? Well, to be poor in spirit, the word poor is poverty stricken, destitute. See, to be poor in spirit, these are those who recognize their spiritual bankruptcy. They recognize their need for God. This person realizes his unworthiness before God and his absolute dependence on God. New Testament scholar Robert Gulick, he says, the poor in spirit are those who stand without pretense before God, stripped of all self-sufficiency, self-security, and self-righteousness. And I think that captures it. Now, one thinks, at least I do, of the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. This is what comes to my mind. All right, you remember Jesus in this parable. He tells this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. You see, he's telling this parable for those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. You know, so that's the target of the parable. They're specifically identified, you see. So the target of the parable is the religiously smug. The religiously smug, those who saw themselves as worthy before God because they obeyed so well. I mean, look, you're fortunate to have me, God. Have you paid attention to what I do? Have you seen how I live? This is who they are. Not all Pharisees are like this, by the way, but there are enough of them like that, that Jesus can speak of them that way. And so he sits here. These are the religiously smug. They saw themselves as worthy because of how they obeyed and who treated with contempt those they perceived as not being sufficiently devout. So not only are they saying, listen, you know, we are really something. You're fortunate to have us. We're worthy of you because of how well we obey. But along with that is this attitude of contempt for people that they looked at as not being their equals. And so they look down on those kinds of people. And the Pharisee, he stands and prays. He prays about himself, really. Now, he opens with a nod toward God, but then the content of his prayer is about his superior piety in relation to other people. It is self-congratulatory. That's the content of his prayer, and it shows disdain for those he judges to be morally defective. The tax collector, on the other hand, the tax collector's sense of his sin is reflected, first of all, by his standing far off. He stands far off. He feels unworthy to be among others who've gathered at the temple for prayer. He just feels, I am not worthy. And so he stands far off as a reflection of that feeling. He wouldn't even lift his eyes to heaven, which was a common posture for praying at that time. He wouldn't do it because of his sense of guilt. He wouldn't even do that. And he's beating his breast. This is a sign of anguish and contrition. That just seems weird to us. But this is a cultural expression of anguish and contrition. You can see, for example, in Luke 23:48. And his prayer is simply, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Scott pointed out several weeks ago, he literally says, the sinner. You see? Now, that's often translated, a sinner. But he says, the sinner, and it reflects, see, he feels that he is a distinctive sinner. That's his spirit. That's his heart. That's how he sees himself. And then Jesus delivers this shocking verdict in verse 14, that the tax collector went home justified before God, whereas the Pharisee did not. That's pretty powerful. You got to get the setting and the environment. I mean, that's powerful. He delivers that verdict, and the reason is that everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. You're fortunate to have me, Lord. You know, I'm quite a guy. All of that. I'm exalting myself. Everyone who exalts himself, meaning this sense, what's going to happen to him? He will be humbled. But the one who humbles himself will be exalted by God. you see, will be exalted by God. In other words, the way to justification, which is entrance into the kingdom, is only by God's mercy, and that mercy can be received only by one who recognizes his need for it. You cannot enter the kingdom of God standing up and saying, listen, let's bargain, let's negotiate. I'm going to come in, but we're going to come in on my terms. You're not coming in. You're not coming in. And that's the point of what he's saying. See, those who seek to lay claim to God on the basis of good works, they are left to stand on those good works. And I have news for you that if you think you can stand before an absolutely righteous, atomic, white, holy God on the basis of your performance, well, then you've got deeper theological issues. You see, and you need a little bit of introspection about your own heart and what motivates you in doing things and all that kind of stuff. But see, if you choose to stand on your performance before God, that is what you will stand on, and that will leave you unjustified. Those who are poor in spirit, they come begging for mercy. That's the idea. See, they come begging for mercy. They have no swagger. They got no attitude. Coming in like this, you know. I got stuff. You see? None of that. They come empty, recognizing, you see, that they're in no position to make any demands, to have any conditions. They just fall before the Lord Almighty. They come seeking mercy without reservation. We sing a hymn sometimes, the Rock of Ages, that includes these words, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked, come to thee for dress. Helpless, look to thee for grace. Foul, I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. That's it. You see, that's it. That is the spirit that comes broken before God. And the Lord God responds to such a spirit with blessing and comfort, as the Spirit spoke through David in Psalm 51, 16 and 17. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You'll not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Now, this is the rub oftentimes. We talk about evangelism and getting people to come to the kingdom. This is a huge thing. It's for somebody to acknowledge and confess that I am a sinner, alienated from God, and I have nothing to bring to God. I have nothing here to stand before God that will justify me in His sight. Because we are so bent on saying, you know, I'm really quite a guy. I can bring people, oh, he did this. Oh, he helped me when I was moving, he did this. He did that. He's helped me here. Oh, wonderful guy. And we actually believe our own press and get to this idea. You see, that we can come and stand before God. This is what does, this brokenness before God. The kingdom, it's not received. The kingdom is not received on the basis of intelligence, social class, nationality, strength, wealth, none of that. The kingdom is given to those who are broken before God, those who acknowledge their need and their helplessness. That's who comes into the kingdom. That's who receives it. Now, Luke's Sermon on the Plain, as you probably know, Luke speaks only of the poor. See, Luke doesn't add poor in spirit. He simply refers to the poor in Luke chapter 6, verse 20. But you see, you'll say, well, there's a difference here. See, they're talking about different. They're not talking about different things. You see, poor in spirit simply fleshes out what is meant when Luke speaks of the poor. Already in the Old Testament, the poor had religious overtones. See, it occasionally stood for those who, because of sustained economic deprivation or social distress, they had confidence only in God. You see, they were beat down. And so they oftentimes just trusted in God. You see, in James, who is it who are exploiting them? All of these rich people around them, he says, you know, the poor, hasn't he chosen you to be rich in faith? Yes, he has. Don't tell the health and wealth preachers that. They're making too much money selling this other thing. But you see this idea that being poor and being this way. See, wealth and privilege can entail great spiritual peril. That is why you see so many warnings about wealth. Can wealth be used right? Yes. Can you in stewardship of wealth be a blessing to people? Yes. But can it be a trap? Absolutely. That is why there are all those warnings about it. You see, it's like dealing with fire. You got to be careful with it, because it will suck you in and you will give it your trust. You will make an idol out of that readily, for sure, you see. Poverty, on the other hand, it can be turned to an advantage if it fosters humility before God, as you see in these people in the Old Testament. That's why I say when Luke speaks of the poor, what he's talking about are the poor as understood through the Old Testament context, those who are, for that reason, poor in spirit, and who thus see. So they're saying the same thing. Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1, it indicates that the Messiah will preach good news to the poor. That's a text that Jesus applies expressly to himself. In Luke chapter 4, verses 18 to 21, you can also look in Matthew chapter 11, verse 5. So in this beatitude here, this first beatitude that we have, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the poor. You see, we not only get teaching about the kind of brokenness that is necessary for entrance into the kingdom of God, but we also get messianic implications through this echo of Isaiah 61. You see, this said, blessed are the poor. And that's what Jesus is doing. Here he is now teaching them. What's he saying to them? Blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Is that the first bell or second bell? Okay, all right. Well, then I get to keep going. Good. All right. 5:4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. This is another allusion to Isaiah chapter 61, specifically to verse 2, where it's said of the Messiah that he will comfort those who mourn. Here's Jesus speaking. He announces the kingdom. He's working miracles. Here come this crowd. And then here he is echoing Isaiah, this messianic text. And he says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Now the context of Isaiah 61 makes clear that this mourning that is spoken of there in Isaiah, the mourning is a sorrow over Israel's exile in Babylon, which was punishment for their sinful rebellion. That's what the mourning's about. This isn't mourning over the loss of a loved one, although many loved ones were lost. But this is mourning over the exile of Judah in Babylonian captivity because of their sinful rebellion. The mourning to which Jesus is referring here, this is a mourning over sin, a grief that flows from the conviction that by rebelling one has done a shameful and terrible thing by dishonoring and disrespecting the Almighty God who is the giver of life and of every good gift. You see, it is grief over that, where one comes to this conviction of what your sin really is. We treat it as though it's so trivial. That's the what? You know, I sin, you sin, we all sin, who cares? You see, we treat it so trivially. And that's not, you know, this idea of mourning for sin. Mourning over. You recall how Paul in 1 Corinthians 5, 1 and 2, he rebuked the church there for tolerating in their midst one who was blatantly sexually immoral, telling him instead of being arrogant, they should have what? Mourned. Do we even talk that way? What if he said to somebody, you know, you ought to mourn over your sin? What are you, legalist? My sin's no big deal.
No, I'm trying to be biblical.
You see, I'm trying to take sin for the horror that it is and not trivialize it and not just hop over it and say, well, it's all right, it's no big deal. And this idea of mourning over sin, James chapter 4, verses 4 through 10, James issues a clear call for his readers there to repent of the hostility and divisiveness of the world that they had absorbed, that they had embraced. And I'd have to take you all the way through James to get you to see this. But this is what he's talking about to them there. He's calling them to repent of that. And he says, he ends that appeal in James 4, verses 8 through 10. He says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy into gloominess. Humble yourselves before the Lord. That sounds familiar. And he will exalt you. You see, humble yourselves before the Lord. And you see this link here. There's overlap in these first several of these attitudes and spirits that Jesus is speaking about. But this idea of mourning sin is something that's foreign to us. Brokenheartedness over sin, that's a prelude to repentance, to surrendering one's life to God without reservation. It is a prelude. There are no rationalizations. There are no excuses. There's only confession and repentance. See, so those who enter the kingdom and thus receive the blessings are not only poor in spirit, they're not only acutely aware of their spiritual bankruptcy and their utter dependence on God, they also grieve over their sin and are thereby driven to turn from it. When John the Baptist came, preaching as the herald of the kingdom-bringing Christ, right? Jesus is bringing the kingdom. John the Baptist is out there blowing the herald. He's the herald. He's coming. Who's coming? The one everybody's been waiting for. The kingdom bringer is coming. And when John the Baptist, who's the herald of the kingdom bringing Christ, he goes out and his message was, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And he says, bear fruit in keeping with repentance. Matthew 3:1 and Matthew 3:8. See, those who remain casual about their sin, those who remain hardened to its true horror, they will not experience the blessings of the kingdom. They will not receive those blessings, but those who in grief turn to God, they will be comforted, and they will be comforted now with the knowledge and the sense. I heard that bell. Let me finish this. That sense of His forgiveness and His reconciliation, and they will be comforted ultimately when they share in the blessed state of the consummated kingdom, that perfect reality in which there will be no sin, no suffering, no mourning, no crying, and no pain. As expressed in Revelation chapter 7, verse 17, for the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and He will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The ultimate fulfillment of these things will be in that state and in that reality. We have them now. We are comforted now. But there is a dimension to that comfort that we have yet to experience, and it's coming. It's coming as sure as I'm standing here. Thank you.